I'm with Max Garett, and I just found out his position is called the Replicator, which sounds like some kind of cool transformer.
The Replicator.
But what is it that you do here?
Here in the replication shop, we make or recreate objects that can be real or authentic for exhibits.
So everything that people see in the exhibits, that some kind of animal shape or recreation of a model, it's made in-house.
So that could be, anywhere from an animal to maybe an artifact, bones, remains, fossils, food.
That's awesome.
A lot of food.
I did not even know until I started working here that many of the things were actually made here. So I think it's really cool that you have this prop shop of sorts.
We're working on an exhibit, biomechanics. Some things we have here are some baby loggerhead sea turtles.
They're really cute.
The story behind them is the kind of built-in GPS they have to migrate to the ocean, but this is something that I sculpted and then I took a mold of and then cast in a more durable material. So this is a touchable.
Whoa.
And so something like this needs to be really strong so that anyone in the exhibit can't break it. So these are...
like kid-proof.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
And they're pretty desirable, too, just to kind of take and stick in your pocket, so...
Oh, yeah.
They have to be, yeah, down on the deck pretty hard.
You caught me. You guys are going to, like, check my pockets before I go. We have, like, 12, like, baby sea turtles.
Exactly. We made some extras just because...
because they're cute!
They're so cute. They're adorable. So this is, you know, cast in a plastic that is almost indestructible, painted with a paint that's really... durable, just from everyone rubbing it and everything.
Yeah.
It's also really fun to make non-touchable objects. That's because you get it, you know, this, we're really restricted on the materials we can use. Can't always come out exactly how we like it, but something like this Venus flytrap, which is not a touchable, it's going to be under kind of an acrylic dome, was really fun to work on and think about because I got to use any material I wanted. So I could use a pretty nice rubber, paint it with something that's not too durable but looks really good, and airbrush it. In the Venus flytrap, there's trigger hairs. There's three trigger hairs on each pad, and that's what kind of makes the trap close on its prey and everything. So I'm gonna have to inlay some little hairs in there too, which is really cool.
Is this actual size? Is this how big they are?
Oh yeah, no, this is a 5 scaled up enlargement.
Oh, okay,
because
this would be terrifying if I was in the forest. Like this would eat a person.
I know, something like a video game or, yeah.
Yeah, oh, like Mario.
Mario, yeah. Something like this also is a touchable, so this kind of snake is cast into, this is like all one solid piece, so this the same plastic, so it can never be, you know, really ripped off or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And also needs to be painted with something that won't rub off.
This is the flying snake.
Yeah, this is the paradise flying snake. And
that sounds terrifying.
Yeah, this kind of touchable part right here is why it's kind of hanging off, and you can feel it's a heart was sculpted into it because the way it kind of glides is it flattens its ribs, and one kind of defining feature is that its heart. Becomes pronounced in its chest because it flattens out. So it's kind of a nice little area where you can mess around with that.
That's cool.
All the kind of acrylic items are going to be pretty awesome because they're all going to be mounted and displayed on these kind of like really big LED light discs and just like illuminated from above. Yeah, so these are in these cast in these nice water clear resins, which are really beautiful. And just to display the different chambers, we're going to have a variety of different animals. I think this is a turtle heart. But it's really like a turtle, fish, amphibian, and you know, these are all not to scale, but to see the different chambers and everything. And these are just some different talons, different bird talons, like a harpy eagle and stuff like that.
They're beautiful. So what else do you have? You have like giant worm?
Yeah, this large worm diorama.
Is this to scale?
The worm actually is, yeah. This is from Queensland, Australia. It's this large blue worm that gets to be about 3.5 feet long. It's pretty awesome. It's a hydrostatic skeleton, the way it kind of undulates its body to move through tunnels and everything. I got to 3D model this kind of shape and then take it to the CNC machine and then, you know, cut it out.
The CNC being the magic table saw?
Yeah, the beautiful robot that makes things. The kind of overall shape is pretty exact, and to do that by hand would have been pretty difficult, so it was nice to make this shape. But, you know, this was something also that originally we got the information from. And it was basically, you know, like create an excerpt of Earth that can display the worm in its tunnels. We were able to kind of collaborate on a kind of more dynamic shape than just like kind of like a block. So we kind of create this like core sample of Earth kind of.
Do you have real, like, you have real twigs and stuff in there?
Yeah, the top layer was Yeah, it was kind of like a recipe I made of real soy. So yeah, actually, the top is actually not even really replicated, I guess. It's dirt, but it's like embedded with this resin.
I think I would be terrified walking around and then all of a sudden having this giant blue worm stick its head
out of the ground. Yeah, it's pretty fantastic. And this is not even actually one of the largest earthworms.
What?
There's some other ones I get to be about like over 6 feet long, kind of the same size in diameter. But yeah.
I don't even believe that.
This is a giant termite mound, and this is to kind of display the architecture of the termite mound and how the termites diffuse heat through their mounds and how kind of like contemporary architecture recreates that in some buildings today and everything.
Is this actual size? Is this life size?
Yeah, this is on the smaller scale, but this is like the mean size of an actual termite mound.
And termites are not, they're not big.
No, they're tiny. Yeah, they're tiny. And like an actual termite mound too is the what it's made of, their mounds are almost stronger than concrete sometimes. And but so yeah, this is going to be done, you know, almost the same way. This is kind of an under texture of fiberglass and a non-toxic resin we use.
Okay.
And then we cover it in this kind of paste that the other one is covered in, and then texture it to make it look like dirt and earth.
Wow.
So yeah, it starts off like this, and then it kind of goes to that as the next layer, and then we kind of coat it all. But this is, it's too large to travel in one piece, so it's going to be made into two separate pieces that kind of lock into each other.
Yeah, it's massive.
Yeah, it's huge. It's about 9 feet tall. But yeah, this is like the average size of a mound. I mean, they can get way bigger too.
That's insane. Yeah. That makes me want to be an anteater. Like, never-ending food source. I like it. You put Max, you put Kirby.
It's just test, you know?
Yeah. Do you sign your work a lot? Like, hide it in little places? Because I would.
It is fun to, like, try to put little Easter eggs. There are, like, you know, in a lot of dioramas around museums, some little people hide things and stuff that was, you know, made a long time ago. But maybe I'll put something in there.
Whoa!
So that's a scent, so it's going to be displayed like that, but it's to a cartilage needs to be put on there, and then we cast in another water clear resin that's kind of pigmented, kind of pink for it's a synovial fluid, I think it's called, around the cartilage. But so this is what's kind of end up being like and displayed on.
That's amazing.
In a case like that.
So you must learn a lot of like biology and anatomy working in here. Like synovial fluid, that is not a term most people know.
No, this is a recent, thing for me. But yeah, it's great because, I mean, we have to do a lot of research on things also, but a project that comes along, we're given, in-depth information packets by a developer to give us all the information that we need on what we're doing and everything. So yeah, no, there's a lot of research and a lot of learning involved too.
That's cool. Mm-hmm. Learning's cool.
Learning is cool.
We advocate learning on this channel. Is this actual size too?
This is like as big as they get. Yeah.
Someone was a little generous with this model.
Yeah, a little bit.
This thing is pretty big though. I would not want to be swimming and then run into this guy.
No.
Its eye is as big as my hand. Mm-hmm. It must be really rewarding when you finally have the exhibit and it opens and people are running around like putting their hands over everything.
Yeah, it's super cool. I mean, for me at least, this is my first time in the replication shop making a lot of stuff from scratch and everything. It's been, since I've been here, it's a lot of like recreating things for shows that have already been built. So it's been nice to make things from scratch and have some creative freedom and to change what an object looks like,
I would have never imagined like having this kind of job, like having, you know, something where you have to be scientifically inclined, you have to understand the reason why you're trying to make something like this, make it presentable and make it fun. So what is your background in?
I studied sculpture at SAIC, School of the Art Institute of Chicago.
Nice.
And I graduated in 2012. I was interning here my last semester, and then they hired me.
That's nice. So you haven't even been here that long.
A year and a half. Yeah, it's good.
How's it been?
Fantastic.
Good.
Love it.
Good. Yeah. We didn't even pay him to say that.
No. That's well,
well
yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Still has brains on it.